And we're also going to, we'll also be sharing our presentation slides today from our presenter, so that we also have those handy. So hopefully that'll be pretty helpful. This is a pretty complex subject, so we imagine you'll have lots of questions. So we're going to go ahead and wait until the end of the presentation to tackle those. But we're going to make sure that the no question goes unanswered. Even if we can't get them all tonight, you'll have contact information for us at PMA, as well as Tiffany at her law firm. So that way you can follow up with us to make sure that, you know, you're getting that essential information you need to get the right type of care you need. If this is your first time joining us, welcome. My name's Beverly, and I'm the communications manager for People's Memorial Association. We're the oldest and largest memorial society in the US. We were founded back in 1939, so we are celebrating our 85th anniversary of being here in Seattle. I think we look pretty good for our age, frankly. It's a good eye cream is the secret, I think. So what we do is we provide essential funeral education and consumer advocacy services to all Washingtonians. And to date, over 219,000 people have become members of PMA. And of those, about 71,000 of them are currently living. So we stay incredibly busy in the office. Luckily, we've hired two new people recently, and it's gonna be so good. I'm so excited, you guys. So in terms of what we do to support all those folks, because that's a pretty beefy group of folks to support, well, education is one of the core things there. So we do community classes just like this, and we host a bevy of free resources on our website and our Facebook and our Instagram. And if I can ever trick my colleagues into learning a little dance choreography, maybe you'll see us on TikTok. But it's been a tough sell so far, but you keep crossing your fingers for me. In addition to that education work, we're really proud of the work we're able to do to support our state level legislature in increasing funeral choice, increasing price transparency in a notoriously opaque industry, the funeral industry, and also working to protect cultural rights. If you've spent any time at all in Washington, you know we have an incredible diversity of peoples here, and all of them deserve equal access to affordable and dignified end-of-life care, whether that's cremation or burial or alkaline hydrolysis or natural organic reduction, plus all those meaningful social, cultural, and religious traditions that help us grieve and celebrate the lives of those we've lost. Sometimes actually we also get to do some work at the federal level, and it's been really exciting. We've been working pretty hard with a bunch of folks over at the Federal Trade Commission to see if maybe we can create some more federal protections for consumers. So keep your eye on our newsletter, and hopefully I will be able to share some great news about that soon. Oh, hey. Oh, I'm going to skip over that for now. But if you ever want to talk about member benefits or more of what we do to support our community, reach out to us at PMA. We're happy to talk about it. Our whole thing is educating people and answering questions, so don't be shy. But I know the real reason we're all here is to benefit from the sagely wisdom of our friend Tiffany Gorton from KHBB Law. She's going to give us a little bit of a primer on what estate planning is all about. And I think we're going to be in very capable hands. Yeah, welcome, Tiffany. It's so good to see you in person. That happens so rarely.
Woo-hoo. I know, right? So here's your Spice Girl mic. And then here's this. I'm going to go ahead and change slideshows over to your slideshow.
Thank you. Okay, so this is very exciting because I have not given very many presentations in person since pandemic, so I'm very excited to be here. It does feel like 2019, and for a little bit of it feels like about 10 years ago based on some of the faces in this room. So raise your hand if you haven't volunteered or been on the board for the PMA. Show of hands, who has not done that? Okay. Well, this is really exciting. I'm glad to see a lot of familiar faces, and thanks to everybody who's joining us online as well. A silver lining of the last several years is that we can reach so many folks in this type of a setting, but also using our online capabilities as well. So what we're going to talk about tonight is probably not going to be super earth-shattering, but just kind of thinking about some really foundational pieces of estate planning, talking about kind of not necessarily myth busters, maybe a few myth busters, but just kind of talking about some of the phrases that we run into, the language that we run into, and just kind of thinking through, some of the basic concepts on which we build. So these kind of go across the board for, you know, whether you have a Buick and a bass fiddle, or many millions of dollars in which we have to get out our tax tools to help with those. These are kind of some of the basic principles, which I think, kind of apply for everyone just in terms of the information and making an informed decision. Because that really is, as Beverly said, kind of the educational component, giving you information, you know, so that you can ask the right questions, do additional research, make sure that you get a plan that is kind of tailored to you. So I don't work for the government, but the one thing, and a lot of the folks in this room and probably online have heard me make this joke before, the two things in life that are certain are death and taxes. So I have a lot of my practice focuses on the tax side, including estate taxes, gift taxes, et cetera. We're not gonna spend a lot of time on that because like I said, we're really gonna talk about some of the foundational pieces, but just having some of the details to kind of keep in mind as you're kind of thinking through and navigating your own planning. There are a couple of, like I say, phrases, a couple of taxes that we hear a lot about. The estate tax is one of them. And you probably hear a lot about the federal estate tax exemption, because our friends in Washington have really increased significantly over the last few years, the exemption amount for each individual. So right now that amount is $12,920,000. So I hope to have a federal estate tax problem. I don't currently. And I think that the number, I can't remember specifically the number, but it is in the low hundreds, the number per year of folks that there is actually going to be tax owed at the federal level. So consider yourself lucky if you run into this. But it is important to think about, and one note about that number, which is huge right now, and will adjust for inflation in the coming year, is given the current statutes look like, current law looks like, at the end of 2025, that number is actually set to sunset and will go down back to the $5 million exemption amount that we experienced several years ago. And that will be adjusted for inflation at about $7 to $7.5 million is what we, you know, can expect in terms of if we do nothing, if the lawmakers do nothing and we just kind of ride out time, at the end of 2025, that number is going to go down significantly to about $7 or $7.5 million. So that will affect obviously more people than almost 13 million, but still a big number. Washington State does have its own estate tax, and this is a significant portion of my practice personally, because as you can see, the $2,193,000, which is a large number, but living in King County, a lot of us probably have seen increase in our property values over the last several years. And so this, as you can imagine, this figure for, does affect a significant number of Washingtonians, particularly in our region. And so although most folks don't have an issue at the federal level, thinking about the $2 million number, which I'll refer to it as the $2 million number for ease of statements and speaking, that we do have our own estate tax. And so being cognizant of that as you kind of think through planning and looking at, you know, all of my assets, do I have life insurance, which doesn't feel like an asset because we can't really spend it or use it during our lifetime so much, but it's counted for estate tax purposes. So thinking about life insurance, real estate, investment accounts, retirement accounts, all of those things combined add up. Do they add up to over 2 million? Then you want to make sure that you're at least thinking about, you know, stopping and pausing and thinking about whether or not you need to do some estate tax planning, unless you have an affinity for the Department of Revenue, in which case, leave it to them. So just another note about the Washington estate tax and what that looks like in terms of how it affects folks is it's a graduated tax. So you can see that it is between 10 and 20%. So in the grand scheme of tax rates, it's not huge comparatively speaking to up to some other states, but it can be significant depending on the amount of exposure in a state to, which means above 2 million, the amount of exposure can go from, like I say, 10 to 20%. At the Fed level, it's from 18 to 40 and it creeps up very quickly. So we bill that as a 40% tax, which is pretty significant. But again, that is anything that's over that $12 million figure, almost $13 million, that's set to sunset back to about $7.5 million in 2025. Okay. So we're not going to talk about taxes the whole time, but I did want to, like I say, give you kind of a flavor of, hey, maybe I want to think about this. Maybe I don't. You're chatting with your neighbor. Maybe your neighbor wants to think about it. Maybe they don't. But just making sure it's on your radar as you're kind of thinking through some of these concepts. So the other kind of things and thoughts to consider regarding estate planning issues, and these affect significantly more people than the estate tax. It's not always, we don't let the tax tail wag the dog, I like to say. But these are some of the things to be thinking about as you're, kind of navigating estate planning and thinking about if you need to set something up or if you need to, make some changes to something that exists. And one other question, this time you don't have to raise your hand, but if you think about it, in this room, think about raising your virtual or make-believe hand of, do you have an estate plan? Maybe you do, maybe you don't. What do you think? In your own mind, answer the question. Well, the answer is yes, you do, regardless of whether you've executed a will or a trust, because we all have estate plans according to what the good folks here in Washington have set up for us under the intestacy statutes, which we'll talk about in a little bit. So one way or another, if something happens to Tiffany Gorton, whether assets pass under my will, by beneficiary designation, in a trust, or I've done nothing, I have a plan. It's whether I elected to use the Washington state plan by doing nothing or have kind of made some intentional planning, taken some intentional planning steps via wills, trusts, et cetera. So something will happen to assets at death is the point that I'm making. And it's important not only for the tax purposes that we talked about, but making sure that your intentions and your wishes are carried out. You get to direct your plan. So like I say, we've got a default. There's some intestacy statutes in Washington that provide where things go if we do nothing, but making sure that we are able to direct that to the extent that we want to is really what's kind of the key here. So a couple of the things to think about, if you're incapacitated, who can you rely on to take care of your finances, to make sure that your healthcare decisions, things that you would do for yourself if you had capacity, to make sure that those things are carried out. Similarly, if you have minor children, making sure that in the event of incapacity, that there is someone on deck, so to speak, to serve as guardian and make sure that the wheels stay on the bus all the way to school until they're 18 and can presumably, they're going to be characterized as adults at that point, but making sure that kind of the life as we know it carries on to the extent that it is able to with somebody else in the driver's seat. If you have a terminal illness and you are in a permanent unconscious condition, do you want life support measures or not? And that is a whole section in and of itself, which probably most folks in this room and probably online are very aware of, because I know who travels in this community. But that is a big one, just to make sure that, the finances are important, the taxes are important, but ensuring that what happens to our individual selves in the event of incapacity is very important. And frankly, I think kind of the most important piece. Following death, do you want to donate your organs, your eyes, your tissues, your entire body? Do you want those things to go simply for life-saving measures for others or for medical research? Do you want to have your remains cremated, buried, et cetera, aquamated, alkaline hydrolyzed, and or what is the most recent one? Composted, yes. So we are pioneers in Washington and have a lot of options. I'm holding out for sky burial. So some things to think about at the outset of kind of the discussions, following your death, who's going to be the beneficiaries? Beneficiaries? Who would you want to receive your stuff? Are there charitable organizations? Shameless plug, Seattle Public Library, People's Memorial Association. are there organizations that you care about and support during life, or that you just care about and want to support in death, making sure that you have remembered them and documented your intentions there? If you, you know, have descendants, you know, children, grandchildren, siblings, other family members that you want to inherit or you don't want to inherit, making sure that those wishes are documented so that your, again, your wishes are carried out. In the event that, you know, kind of going one further, we like a backup to our backups. If there is, you know, none of the individuals that you are important in terms of who you want to benefit are there at death, then who gets everything or who gets, you know, various things? Are there beneficiaries who would benefit from utilization of a trust? And this is an important one. We'll talk about this some more. I've listed them there. Minor beneficiaries. Is there, you know, somebody in your life that has a special need that would qualify for federal or other government or charitable benefits that you want to make sure that you're providing for them, but not eliminating them or disrupting benefits that they're receiving? More and more, I see this even with adult beneficiaries who are very financially responsible, but parents in particular, thinking about potential estate tax issues for the next generation. So not only in my own life, when I have to worry about if I have $2 million or not, and if the DOR is going to get a portion of that, but thinking about my children, so to speak, and what long-term planning they may or may not do. And in the future, when they're talking to their nice estate planner, thinking about their own estate taxes, whether assets have flowed into a trust for their benefit or to them outright makes a difference from a tax perspective for them in the future. Similarly, we don't get to pick who our kids marry. So this is another one that parents really like, thinking about ensuring that, you know, Tiffany Gorton family assets remain Gorton family assets and aren't commingled, you know, with Mr. Smith who comes along and, you know, marries my child. Nothing nefarious. Maybe that person just has different spending habits than my child. And also, you know, those are family assets and maybe they should stay in the family. Not necessarily, but these are the things that are worth considering on top of minor beneficiaries or some type of a government benefit that may be affected by that type of, by having assets outright versus going into trust. And we're kind of highlighting here, and we'll talk about those tools and vehicles more in more depth here in a minute. But the last issue that I want to mention that again is attractive to parents, grandparents, folks who have other individuals in their lives who we don't get to make their decisions for them, having assets flow into trust rather than outright, because, you know, young Johnny is a very responsible individual, but he gets into a fender bender and the other driver wants to sue him. Well, the assets that he inherits outright and go into his bank account would be exposed to potential third-party creditors, like somebody in an accident like that. Whereas assets that have flowed into trust for that person wouldn't necessarily have that same exposure. And so that's something to consider. There's a lot of different types of trusts and different types of vehicles and different reasons that some of them can make sense. So just kind of thinking about some of those kind of gives you a flavor of, you know, you're in control and you have a lot of different options. Okay, so following death, who can you rely on to administer your estate? So this person would be your executor, your personal representative. And what that person does is at death, they're charged with gathering all of the decedent's assets, making sure that creditors are given proper notice, final income tax return is filed. We have ensuring that if I have a house and I pass away, or I die, my house is, you know, remains mine at death, making sure that that's, you know, ready for sale, listed and sold, or otherwise distributed to my beneficiaries. Basically, kind of, it's like closing down a business, but it's for an individual's life. So kind of looking at the big picture of everything that that person had, all of the businesses or kind of things that they had involvement with, and making sure that all of those boxes are kind of closed down, so to speak. So thinking about, you know, who would be important in that role, who in your life would make sense. Do you have a plan for digital assets? Are you storing your passwords someplace? Does someone have access to them? I know this adds like another layer to our lives to make sure that those things are considered. How is your, you know, fiduciary going to find your asset liability information? This goes for both capacity or lack of capacity as well as death. We have, you know, some of us have sticky notes on our desk. Some of us don't have those anymore. But making sure that you have kind of your stuff in an area, or that your fiduciary, your agent for finances or healthcare, or your personal representative, your executor, the person you nominate, knows where those things are. Even if it's a matter of, hey, you know, I work with Tiffany and she has this list in her vault along with my original document. So if something happens, call her. Or I have, you know, there are apps now, of course, that you can store all of your passwords in and, you know, keep kind of secure notes, so to speak, and making sure that your person or your people have access to that in the event that they need it. It could be a filing cabinet at the house where you say, you know what, I have a folder of important papers. It has a lock on it. That's where I keep the passwords. And make sure that you look there. Here's a list of my bank accounts. Here's a list of the financial institutions I have a relationship with. Here's the life insurance companies that I utilize. Okay, so in terms of kind of the tools, now that we're thinking about all of these different issues that could come up both in life and, you know, the inevitable, thinking about the power of attorney. I mentioned that I think that the healthcare piece in particular is the most important, but this is really a cornerstone of kind of the foundational planning pieces that we're talking about tonight. So again, as you probably know, or many of you in this room have probably heard of this and may even have these executed. This is a document that takes effect, it's during your lifetime. So this is where you say, you know what, I'm gonna make sure that I have somebody on deck, so to speak, to ensure that if something happens to me, either for a season or for long-term, that there is somebody who can step in for financial purposes and make sure that my mortgage is paid, make sure my taxes are filed, make sure that if I'm over 70 and a half, I'm taking my required minimum distribution for my retirement account, dealing with my CPA, dealing with my financial advisor, paying my rent, doing all the things that we're doing for ourselves financially when all is well and good in the event that something comes up. And either, like I say, either for a season or for a longer term. And I think that this is important to emphasize that a lot of times when we think about durable powers of attorney, particularly in a healthcare position for healthcare, this feels like a role for end of life decisions only. And that's a very important part of the role. We think about this with aging parents and grandparents of, you know, somebody loses capacity and then they're terminally ill, or, you know, they have an accident and there's a decision to be made as to what's going to happen if this person's going to die naturally or you're going to take some heroic measures. That's, I think, where everybody's mind goes when you hear power of attorney. And that's very important. But thinking about both from the financial perspective, as well as the healthcare side, this can actually be a longer term position than just end of life decisions. For example, you know, we're all aging. My parents are aging, and I'm helping my mom with a lot of stuff right now. I'm from Michigan. She lives there. She doesn't live here, but we live in a really technological, good place right now. And so she lives in assisted living. And I work together with her and her healthcare providers and her bank and make sure that, you know, her rent's paid, make sure that the groceries are ordered, make sure that she has her dentist appointments every 6 months and is getting her teeth cleaned. And all of those things that she historically has done on her own, you know, I'm helping out with. And that is something that I've been doing for a couple of years. And that will continue for several years. My mom's not terminally ill. This is something where she just needs some help and is probably going to need some help for a very long time. So the job can be very narrow, but it can also be very kind of a longer term commitment. And so I think thinking about that when you're picking your agent for finances, an agent for healthcare, it's important to be cognizant of that. Because I think we automatically think, oh, this is going to be a very short-term position, but it could be a pretty long tenure. So consider that as you're thinking through who makes sense in your own lives. So somebody's on deck here. So what are the requirements to have a validly executed durable power of attorney? So it needs to be signed and dated and either notarized or attested to by two competent witnesses. And it needs to be in the presence of the principal. And so if I'm signing my own durable power of attorney for myself, I'm the principal, I'm appointing an agent. And it needs to be witnessed in my presence or at my direction or request. Okay, so moving from powers, oh, you have a question, yes.
On the previous slide, mm-hmm. How old does someone have to be?
18. So this is something, that's a great question. Something to consider for our college students or graduates who are going off to college, making sure that as young adults, they are considered adults under the law, that they have something in place. And then similarly, for the witnesses to make sure that, you know, it's not your 15-year-old that's serving as a witness. So, yes. Yep. And for executor, interestingly, or maybe not to you, but interesting to me, who's had to go back to court and tell the court that my client could actually not serve as executor, they can't be a felon. So, okay. So moving forward, so this cat's going to get 9 wills prepared for his 9 lives. So the power of attorney is something that takes effect during life, comes into play in the event of incapacity, whereas a will is something that doesn't take effect until death. So this is something that, you know, we've moved beyond having our own lives kind of continued to be managed financially and for healthcare in the event of incapacity. And this is, we've breathed our last breath and the durable power of attorney is no longer the go-to roadmap or document. Now we're in a place of thinking about utilizing the will, which is going to direct who our executor is or our personal representative and where our stuff's going to go. And again, that might be a Buick and a bass fiddle, or it could be millions of dollars flowing into specialty trusts. We don't care the shape or size, but the tool can remain the same. So we're going to talk about that here. So again, this is not effective until death. You can change it anytime during your lifetime, as long as you have capacity, which legal capacity to change estate planning documents is a kind of a low bar. It's different. It is, you have to know who you are, who your people are, and what you own, basically. And that doesn't mean you have to have every single bank account memorized with the current date's balance. This is just a matter of being able to say, you know, these are the people that I want to receive my things. And so one thing that is interesting regarding that and kind of the capacity issue is we have folks that sometimes have a dementia or Alzheimer's early diagnosis, and that can prompt people to get their ducks in a row if they haven't already, or even think about, you know, just revisiting and making sure that things are buttoned up. And that doesn't disqualify you from being able to make updates and sign your will, as long as you have capacity, which I described as, you know, knowing, you know, what you own and who you want to receive that. So all that to say, you can change this anytime during your lifetime. It's basically a roadmap for distribution of your probate assets at your death. And we talk, I say probate assets specifically there because what a will governs is any assets that you own in your own name. So like for example, I own my house as Tiffany R. Gorton. If that was in a trust, then that would not be a probate asset. It'd be governed by the trust, not by a will. If you had a community property agreement, which is kind of an older school planning tool, but oftentimes married couples will have a community property agreement between them that says everything, you know, to my surviving spouse, but it doesn't provide for what happens at the second death. So that is a document that exists that you may come across. If you have assets and you have a document like that, that's going to govern where things go, not necessarily your will. So just be cognizant of that. Make sure that your intent is reflected there. But basically, life insurance that has a beneficiary designated on it is not going to be a probate asset. That doesn't need to go through probate, so it's not governed by your will. Retirement accounts, if they have beneficiaries associated, beneficiary designations, checking account with a pay on death beneficiary, any type of asset that has its own beneficiary designation that's completed, is not going to fall under the category of a will. Now, some folks say during their planning process, I want to make sure that everything flows under my roadmap. So then they either don't execute execute beneficiary designations, and thereby everything falls in under the will. So as part of the planning process, making sure that the kind of the primary point here is making sure that your intent is known and that all your documents match that. So if you're going to use your beneficiary designations to direct where things go, that's okay. Just make sure it represents your current intent. And similarly, make sure that under the terms of your will, any assets that are going to be governed by the will flow to whomever you are directing. So in terms of what happens and when this document becomes quote unquote effective, so to speak, is at death. Like I say, it's something that you can change during life as long as you have capacity to do it and you're living. But at death, that's when we file a will with the court and a probate may be opened in order to basically gather the assets and make ultimate distributions according to the roadmap under the terms of the will. I did want to say kind of what the requirements are. We have, it needs to be written, it needs to be signed by the testator. So if I'm making my own will out, I'm the testator, and it needs to be signed by two or more competent witnesses in my presence. As you can imagine, during the pandemic, this got a little fuzzy, the presence of the testator, huh? Well, I can't come in your house. So what are we going to do here? So we got very creative. There were a lot of curbside signings, a lot of signings with garage doors open and things taped out at 6 feet. So as long as you can see, even if it's through the window, making sure that those witnesses have seen you sign. The alternative tool, kind of a will substitute. Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Right.
Does the person who's designated beneficiary get access to those assets immediately upon your death, or still?
That's a great question. So if you have an asset that has a beneficiary designation, so my retirement account goes to Mr. Smith, my neighbor, on the beneficiary designation. He, Mr. Smith, is entitled to that asset at my death. And the way that he gets access to it is typically you provide a death certificate to the financial institution, Schwab or whomever, and then Schwab will say, okay, you know, we're opening a sub account for Mr. Smith and we're transferring the funds. It doesn't have to go through the probate process. So if I were to die with a, you know, $10 million retirement account, that's my only asset, even though that's a lot of money, I don't have to use the probate process if I have a beneficiary designation executed on that account. So if that whole $10 million is going to Mr. Smith or 10 other people, but as long as my beneficiary designation indicates that, then I don't need to go through probate because that's the only asset in that circumstance. Yeah. That's a great question. So how does, yes, yes. So how does the state view your estate for estate tax purposes if all of your assets have beneficiaries designated on them? So if all my assets are financial accounts or life insurance or something similar, and they're all designated to my various beneficiaries, and there's no probate requirement, what does the state say about that? That is still a taxable estate. And so if you have those assets, like in my $10 million retirement account example, that asset would flow to the correct owner, and it doesn't require a probate, but you still got to pay the piper. So I would still have technically a taxable estate, even though I didn't necessarily have to utilize the probate process. So what would happen then is two things. One, when you get into a circumstance like that, nobody wants to write a check back to the Department of Revenue after they've received funds, right? But so what would happen in a circumstance like that is whomever was designated as the executor, or if you had a trust, then as the trustee, would be charged with, part of their job is filing your estate tax return. So they have to say, hey, hey, Mr. Smith, I know that this $10 million is coming to you, but first the Department of Revenue is going to get their cut. Yes. Questions at the end. Okay. Yep. Let's do this last one. You want? Okay, perfect. All right. So we talked about the will as kind of one of the primary tools for post-death as a roadmap to where assets go. The alternative is a revocable living trust. And this is something that got a lot of press play in kind of the 90s, early 2000s. Like probate, which is not a bad word, and we'll talk about that in a second. A revocable living trust isn't a bad word either, but there were some outfits that were kind of like trust mills that just prepared a revocable trust for everybody. And then there's also like there's a Susie Orman package that you can get, and it is a revocable living trust for any state that you might live in. So there's a little bit of, you know, there's some jokes about that and some, you know, kind of not great behavior on the part of some folks going back several years. But this is an actual tool that can be really useful. It's only in certain circumstances. And again, these are things to think about when you're wanting to have something tailored for yourself or working on something for yourself. Just because a revocable trust makes sense for your neighbor doesn't mean that it necessarily makes sense for you. And it certainly doesn't make sense for everybody in the room. And this is basically an asset that is, a tool that's active during life. So if I were to use, if I said, you know what, I'm going to use a revocable trust instead of a will because it makes sense for me and my assets and my life, then I execute that during life. There's some title changes that are involved with that. So for example, I own my house as Tiffany R. Gorton right now. If I had if I execute a revocable living trust and I want to avoid probate, because that's one of the things that it does, even though that's okay, it's okay to go to probate in Washington, I would title my house as Tiffany R. Gorton, trustee of the Tiffany Trust. And then that asset is in that trust. It's no longer a probate asset, no probate required, as long as, you know, I don't have other assets hanging around out there. So it is, like I say, it's active during lifetime in that way. Meaning if that's a tool you set up and you go to the trouble to set this up as your primary tool, then you should fund it. You change your title to your to the assets that you own to be in the name of your trust. Doesn't change anything from an income tax perspective. And the example I gave regarding myself, I still pay income tax. I still deduct mortgage interest. I still pay my bills, my house, my mortgage, all those things the same way that I would otherwise. It's just that there's a little bit of a different title. Similarly, it doesn't save estate taxes. So it's something where it's not a tax savings vehicle. It's a probate avoidance tool. And so when I talk to clients and say, hey, consider this, and what I'm saying to all of you in this room is, as you're thinking about your own planning, do you own any real estate in another state, particularly California? Because if you do, this could be a tool that makes sense because, like I say, probate's not a bad word. It's okay to go to probate in Washington. We'll talk more about that in a second. But where you get into an expense and your efficiency and cost effectiveness is outweighed is, say I have property in California. There, their probate process is very expensive and it can take a long time. They charge a percentage of assets as their probate fee. That's different than what we do here. Here, you pay a $240 filing fee and you're off to the races in terms of being able to administer the estate. If I had a property in Idaho or in Oregon, not necessarily bad probate states, but if I have to have a probate in Washington and a probate in Oregon, because I have real estate in Oregon too, then you start to, you know, if you're having to do probates in multiple states or your heirs are having to do probates in multiple states, then it's worth considering utilizing a trust, because if my real estate here in Washington is in my trust and my real estate from Oregon is in my trust, then there's not going to be a probate in that extra state. So that's one time, that's the primary time where I recommend it for clients to at least consider, is if you have real estate in another state, it could be a tool that makes sense for you. If you, some folks will say, you know what, I moved here from California, or I moved here from another state and I have a revocable trust. That's the tool that I've been using. I want to do, you know, an amendment and restatement so that it comports with Washington. I'm used to this tool, so I'm comfortable with it. That's fine enough for me. It's your tool. And so that's, you know, a fine enough reason is familiarity. Or if you've administered a revocable trust for a parent or another family member, and it's simply, you know, a preferred tool for you, that's okay. It's not, there's nothing bad about that. It's just the primary time when I would recommend and say, hey, at least think about this, is if you have real estate in another state. I mentioned that probate is not a dirty word and is not a bad place to go. It's not like purgatory, or hell. What is it? So probate is actually a court supervised process of settling a dead person's quote unquote life business. So I said before, you know, we gather all the assets. We make sure that that the income tax return is filed. If there's an estate tax return, we make sure that that's filed, any taxes are paid. And then we liquidate assets if that is what makes sense under the plan, or we otherwise distribute assets. So it's kind of that final closing up shop, so to speak, on somebody's financial life. And probate is the court supervised process of doing that. So I mentioned when somebody dies, we file the will with the court, we pay our $240 filing fee, and then the executor is appointed. And unless that person's a felon, they're off and running and managing the assets and kind of gathering things and paying bills and they're able to make distributions. They're getting everything buttoned up, so to speak. So that process is not scary or bad. The court doesn't have to approve every single thing that we do. And the expense is not high. There's a filing fee. After you're done administering the estate, you go back and tell the court, I'm finished. Here's my declaration of completion. And then 30 days later, you're out of your position's over. With a revocable living trust, what happens is you have a trust administration. So you either have a probate under the will or in the laws of intestacy, then you're dealing with the court in a limited capacity, or you have a trust administration. So you're, to some degree in Washington, it can be six of one, half dozen of the other in terms of the associated expense and what the job looks like. The job looks very similar because even if you have a revocable trust, like my Tiffany R. Gorton Trust and my house is in there, it doesn't automatically transfer to Mr. Smith, the neighbor, who's my beneficiary in this example, simply because I've died. So what happens is with the trust scenario, the trustee comes along, gathers the assets, pays the taxes, buttons everything up, transfers the house or sells the house, and then transfers the proceeds to Mr. Smith or the other beneficiaries. So there's either an executor who's doing the legwork or a trustee who's doing the legwork, just depending on what tool there is. So again, in Washington, probate is not, you know, the worst thing in the world. In some states it is, but here we're fortunate in that we have a pretty streamlined process. Okay, so I mentioned kind of what their job is. Again, very similar to what the trustee does if you utilize a revocable living trust. Non-probate assets, we talked a little bit about this already. We talked about assets that have a beneficiary designation on them, property that's held in trust, life insurance, because it has a beneficiary. The top one, joint tenants with rights of survivorship, is an important one. We didn't talk about that yet. But this is something that if I own an account with my husband, Nick, which I do, and it's a joint tenants with right of survivorship account. So I die, Nick automatically owns the funds in my Bank of America account. Likewise, if something happens to Nick, I own those funds. Where this is, where I will caution you on this, just as this is a freebie, so to speak, is I spend a fair bit of my time in the trust and estate litigation world. So I do a lot of planning and a lot of administration, but I also find myself in litigation circumstances, not based on my own documents, of course, but people will do what they will. And weddings, babies, and funerals brings it out in folks. So people, as you can imagine, get into tussles sometimes related to mom's estate or, you know, whomever's estate. Oftentimes, probably 9 times out of 10, any part of a dispute matter that I'm looking at, there's some account that mom or dad or whomever the decedent had that is titled as joint tenants with right of survivorship account with one out of three kids. So make sure that is you can do that. You don't have to do things equally, but make sure that if your account is titled as joint tenants with right of survivorship, that you are affirmatively saying, I want this entire balance to go to my joint tenant when I die. And that is my oldest child or my middle child or my youngest child or whomever is on that account, because that can become a problem and it is a problem in a lot of estates where, for example, you know, say I have a large investment account and it's titled as joint tenants with right of survivorship. I've added my local child to that account so that they can help write checks or something other than a nefarious reason. Then I die, then suddenly that child owns that entire account, even though my will says equally among my three kids or, you know, to whomever. So just making sure, because that is one where, and I, I could spend an hour talking about financial institutions and how things go with them, but I won't. But a lot of banks will automatically, when you're setting up a bank account, if you're going to put somebody else on it, they're checking a box or their automatic titling is joint tenants with right of survivorship, not necessarily just having somebody as a signor on the account. And so making sure that, and again, it's okay if it's a joint tenant account, as long as you want that person to receive that and understand that. And I don't think that financial institutions do a good job of making that clear. And then somebody dies and we find ourselves in a dispute. When to consider updating your plan. So I said weddings, babies, and funerals bring it out in people. But when there's a wedding, a baby, or a funeral in life, big life events. If you sell your business, if you sell a startup, if you your kids graduate from high school, that's a win, right? They're off to college, they're adults, or they're off doing, you know, whatever it is that they're doing. Just kind of as time goes by, when those big life events happen, and you don't even need to necessarily update your plan at that time. It's just a matter of thinking about, hey, I had another baby. Does my will cover that person? And typically the answer is yes, because we often draft documents to refer to, you know, all my children, here's who exists on the date that I'm signing this, but, you know, I'm dividing things equally among my then living children, which pulls all the future children that are born into that. But just thinking about any of those circumstances, big life events, if you win the lottery, you're going to have a lot of friends, number one, but no, any type of event where there's a significant change in your wealth, addition or subtraction, just making sure that you are considering whether or not something needs to be updated. Okay, with that, thank you. We do have more time for questions, which we promised we would. So Beverly, do you want me to just take questions? Or? Absolutely. Do you want my Spice Girls mic? Okay.
You can tell we're from the same generation.
Right? Oh, I won't need that.
Okay.
Okay, fabulous. Okay, thank you so much for coming out and spending time on a gloomy evening when you could be at home cozy. Hopefully this has been informative. We're going to tackle as many questions as we can conceivably force Tiffany to stay for. But before doing that, I just wanted to plug a couple of things. One of the things that Tiffany alluded to, and I heard some interest in the crowd, is the concept of a digital estate planning. And we actually have, in the past, we've conducted a webinar on that at PMA, and you can actually access that on our website in our webinar library if you'd like to learn more about what you can do to make sure that stuff doesn't hit your family like a freight train and they know where to go to get the essential passwords and all of that stuff. So very important resource. Additionally, I'm a notary, and if you're a PMA member and you are working on getting all of your end of life paperwork sorted and organized, I'm happy to go ahead and notarize your documents for free if you want to make an appointment with us. Hopefully that'll save you a little bit of hassle trying to get all that organized. And then the other thing is that just as a bit of a disclaimer, Tiffany's an attorney, but not your attorney. So if you have questions that are, you know, really specific, or maybe you have sort of complex situations, I'm sure she'll be willing to be able to support you to an extent. But I know a lot of people are a little intimidated by the idea of retaining an attorney because it is a costly thing often. So the Washington State Bar Association and the King County Bar Association both offer free legal clinics periodically. And I'd strongly recommend that as a great starting point if you've got a lot of questions. One of the biggest values there, aside from that it's free to begin with, is that those folks can help you determine whether or not you really should retain an attorney. So you might think you need one thing, and then, you know, you sit and you talk for a couple minutes with them and they say, you know, I really think you should look for someone that specializes in this kind of law. And, you know, you can't put a price on that kind of expert sort of guidance. Okay. So I think we can go ahead and tackle some questions. And I've even got a couple that I'd love you to tackle if we work through these pretty quickly. So hand it back over.
Thank you. Yes, I think that the WSBA, which I've done a number of, I just finished a 5-year stint in the real property probate and trust section. They have a great ability to kind of input people and connect people in a way that is super helpful. King County Bar Association, same thing. They do a lot of neighborhood stuff. So I'm always happy to answer questions. Shoot me an email if we don't get to it tonight and put PMA in the subject line. And so I know who you are. And I'm happy to look at that. But there are tons of resources out there. And the library is a huge one as well. We partner, PMA partners with them. I partner with them a lot. We're really lucky just in terms of kind of where we live and the resources that we have. So I echo what Beverly said there. So questions? Yes.
Does that include resources like land that you might own in another state, or is it only what's owned here in the state of Washington?
So it's Washington assets. If you own that property, like in an LLC, for example. So say you had a rental property in another state and it's in an LLC because you want it to be protected, you know, your other assets to be protected from liability, and it's going to be included in your Washington estate, but not necessarily if it's, you know, you have some property in Montana that's sitting there that, you know, is not in an entity, but you own it as an individual. It'll need to be probated there so that it can be distributed, but not necessarily going to be included, right? And there's something I've had a couple of, if you move there, for example, and this is more than what you wanted to know, but you're seeing how this sausage is made. You move there, for example, but you still have assets here in Washington, and you rise to that level with your Washington assets, there's going to be a different calculation. It doesn't encompass all of your assets, but your Washington property is still going to be subject to tax. So, yes. Hello. Good to see you too. So that's a great question. If somebody's living on Social Security, doesn't have a residence, doesn't have a house that they own, and doesn't really have a lot of assets, are they still going to go through probate? So the question is really, do you have over $100,000 in assets that are not going to pass via beneficiary designation? So say, for example, I had, you know, I live on Social Security in this example, I don't own my house, but I have a retirement account that has more than $100,000 in it and doesn't have a beneficiary designation, then I have to go through probate in order to get that buttoned up. I have to get that account to get directed according to my will or the laws of intestacy. If I don't have that, and I simply have less than $2 million in assets and everything has beneficiary designations associated with it, then no, you're not necessarily going to have to go through probate. Yes, in the back. If you're leaving most everything to charity, is estate tax planning necessary? The answer is kind of no. You've done the estate tax planning for us. With regard to the estate tax, there's an unlimited marital deduction. So any assets that flow to your surviving spouse or to a trust for your surviving spouse at the first spouse's death are not subject to estate tax. So this isn't a circumstance where I die and suddenly my husband Nick has to write a check to the Department of Revenue. assuming that, you know, he's receiving the assets. Similarly, to get to your question, if all my assets are going to charity, even if I have $1 billion, there's not going to be any estate tax due because there's an unlimited charitable deduction there. So there would be technically a reporting requirement in terms of filing a tax return, but there's not going to be tax due. So all the more reason to give to charity. Yeah.
A lot of assets getting transferred.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that's a great question. So the point was made that a lot of assets can be transferred on death without having to go through probate or using your will. You can use your beneficiary designations to transfer your assets, big or small. And that's absolutely right. But the question is, what if it's more than the estate tax amount or the estate tax exemption amount, and there's going to be estate tax due? Then do you leave some assets that are going to go through probate, or how do you manage that? In a perfect world, you would look at all of those things in advance of death and figure out, okay, what makes the most sense here? I'm going to have one account that is, you know, going to be $100,000, and I'm just using that as a round number. I'm going to maintain that without a beneficiary designation so that it's going to pass under my will, and I'm going to draft my document such that, you know, my executor steps in, has this bucket of money, so to speak, and can, you know, pay the taxes, file the tax return and pay the taxes, and then everybody else can go on their merry way. Does that always happen? Not necessarily. So if you don't do that and everything is supposed to flow to, everything has a beneficiary designation and you haven't reserved anything, so to speak, for estate tax payment, what happens is each of those assets that is flowing or would be designated to flow to a beneficiary is technically subject to tax. And so then you get into a position of, does the nominated executor know that, you know, where all those assets are? Is there a quick turnaround at death where that person says, okay, I'm filing the will, I'm getting appointed, I'm reaching out to banks to say, hey, this is a taxable estate, don't distribute. Because what ends up happening there is, say everything is distributed to the designated beneficiaries, the bank's not on the hook for that. They've done, you know, what is directed under the terms of the beneficiary designations. And then you set your executor into a position of having to go collect, you know, pro rata from each of the beneficiaries. All that to say, if you are thinking about that and want to keep things simple, using beneficiary designations, exactly what you asked at the beginning of, you know, should you keep some assets that are not subject to beneficiary designations, so that way your executor has an easy time of being able to finalize the estate and pay the taxes? The answer is yes. So the question is, is it their job to administer the non-probate assets, the pay on death accounts? And the answer is no. In fact, if I'm the executor, unless I'm telling Charles Schwab or whomever the financial institution is that there is a tax issue or there's a dispute, freeze the account, don't distribute it, then what happens is exactly what you described. I'm a beneficiary on an account. I take my death certificate down to Charles Schwab. Charles Schwab does not have to do anything other than follow what the beneficiary designation says, and they'll pay out. The PR, the executor, the personal representative, doesn't have any authority other than alerting the financial institution that there's going to be a tax bill and that the funds shouldn't be distributed. They don't have the ability to even call and say, hey, I need the balance for this account because it's a non-probate asset. So their authority is with regard to probate. The problem is that the assets that fall outside of probate are included in a taxable estate. So all that to say, no, the executor isn't charged with distributing those non-probate assets. The bank will do it automatically. And so you run into a problem of, and then, you know, if the beneficiary has spent the money, by the time the executor and the DOR catch up with them, then it reads like a law school exam question. And then there's essentially a lien against that asset, which has been distributed. So if the beneficiary on an account is a charity, how do they learn that the person has died? How do they know that that asset belongs to them? What do they do? And that's a great question. It depends. So I have an estate that I'm finalizing actually now where the decedent died. They were from a different country, but they lived here. They were a resident here. And so the family wasn't here. But a lot of their assets did go to, you know, were designated for charity. And as representing the personal representative who had to kind of Easter egg hunt to figure out where everything was, you know, I found an asset that was going to the art museum. And so I said, hey, you know, we've learned that you're the beneficiary of this, but don't take the money and spend it because there are some expenses that are due. So it just depends on what the circumstances are, how that kind of comes up. Because it's not necessarily in the executor's purview.
Oh, it's failed and the executor is sitting there and knows they have to pay all these taxes.
That's a great question. So what happens when all the funds get spent and the executor sitting there knowing that they have to pay taxes? If there are assets that have beneficiary designations and were paid out, then the problem really lies with the beneficiaries because the executor didn't do anything knowingly. So they're not going to be personally on the hook. But what happens is the Department of Revenue wants, you know, what's due to them under the law. And then the executor's in a position of saying, hey, non-probate beneficiaries, some of your money needs to be returned to the Department of Revenue because there's a tax bill. And if it's spent, then you get into a debt collecting situation with a beneficiary who probably didn't know and just, you know, spent the money because they got it. So it's to have those kind of things kind of organized in advance. This is kind of the circumstances that can arise if you don't have everything buttoned up, or, you know, there's not somebody that you've appointed as executor, or you've made them made known to them, hey, here's where my assets are, here's what my beneficiary designations say, so that they can act quickly rather than, you know, finding out that a large account exists a year down the road in the probate and it's already been distributed and, you know, they put it all on black and didn't win.
Well, like you said, you have just a separate bank account with no beneficiary, no payment, and just have some money in there for the executor.
So the point being, yes, you should have, in circumstances like that, if you want to utilize your beneficiary designations as a planning tool, having some assets that are set aside without a beneficiary designation to ensure that the taxes are easily paid and that your executor doesn't have to tear their hair out to go, you know, figure out where all these other assets are and try and get money back from beneficiaries is a best practice for sure. Beverly. Sure. So the question is, when you die and you have debt, credit card debt, student loan debt, a mortgage, you know, any number of things where you owe somebody money, what does that look like? There are a couple of things. And the second part of that question is, what if those debts exceed the assets? So what we do as part of a probate or trust administration step, one of the early steps is we give notice to creditors. So we publish notice to the Daily Journal of Commerce saying, Tiffany's died. And you know, if she owes you money, speak now or forever hold your peace. The creditors have 4 months to come and say, they have to present their claim. They have to give that either to the trustee or the executor, whoever's the notice agent. So that way it can be reviewed. If it's a legitimate claim, it can either be approved. If it's legitimate, it can be approved. If it's circumstances where there's more debt than there are assets, then the estate's called insolvent. Similar to if you're going to head over to bankruptcy court and you're insolvent. And what that looks like is kind of a nightmare for somebody who represents the executor. So it's one of the early questions we ask in talking to executors is, hey, what kind of debts do you think are out there? You know, is there enough money in the estate to be able to pay those, pay the expense of administering the estate, and make some distribution to the beneficiaries? So when you die, your debts don't go away. But if you have more more debt than what is in your estate in terms of assets, then there's a kind of a pro rata payment. So say I die and I have $1 million in debt and I only have $500,000 in total assets. Well, those creditors who have properly filed claims are going to get paid partially, but not entirely. And the beneficiaries aren't going to get anything. They're not going to be on the hook for the remaining debt because it's not their personal debt. It was the decedent's, but it's not a fun estate to participate in because there's not the administrative expenses get paid first. So technically the lawyer gets paid, the court costs get paid, the expenses of final illness get paid first, but then you have these creditors and the beneficiaries don't get anything. So that's what happens. And I can take one more. Sure. So great question. When you are revisiting your plan, because you've had change in circumstances, you maybe want to make updates. How do you do that? So it depends. You do not have to hire counsel. You don't have to hire a lawyer to draft any of these documents. My late law partner, Tim Burkhart, used to say, I could wire my own house, but I want to live there. So you don't need counsel to draft a will. You don't need counsel to draft a power of attorney or any of those documents. I will caution you just to make sure that it's very clear that you have done everything correctly. I have a friend who did kind of a study of online resources, and she had her staff go through and set up their own plans using this resource completely, you know, untouched. And one of the issues were it's always operator error, right? There's a drop-down menu for all the states. Well, what one's first? Alabama. We don't live in Alabama, but this person ended up with an Alabama plan, which maybe it works here, but you know, it's not necessarily tailored. All that to say, you don't need counsel to set up your own plan. You don't need counsel to make changes to your will or to your trust or your durable power of attorney. But if you do want to make changes, the issue of kind of writing things in, you know, initialing next to them. We don't have in Washington holographic wills, which means I've handwritten my will and therefore it is valid. Some states do. I'm from Michigan. They historically had a statute that allowed holographic wills or recognized those as valid, regardless of whether they had the two witnesses. We don't have that here. So simply by having something in your hand doesn't necessarily mean that it's valid. If you were to handwrite something as an update, it would still need to be signed and witnessed by two witnesses. And I don't really recommend doing that. If you scratch things out in your will or make notes on the will, then the question becomes, was this person actually trying to revoke this entirely? What was going on here? Because of course, when we see that in a probate, when the person has died and can no longer tell us, you know, what their intention was, it's almost never clear. So it can invalidate the whole thing, which is a shame because you went to the trouble to try and express your intent. So with that, if you guys have anything else, go ahead and email me. Happy to chat, happy to continue to noodle about these things. I spend my whole day doing it because I love it. So thank you so much. And thank you especially to those of you who I know these